right. Praise God. Well, we're gonna read a couple of verses out of the book of Philippians. We're gonna start off in chapter 1, verse 6, and then we'll go to chapter 2 and read verses 12 and 13. I titled this morning's message "Seasons of Change," and so we're gonna go ahead and read Philippians chapter 1, verse 6. It says, "Being confident of this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it," or accomplish it, "unto the day of Jesus Christ." And then if we'll go to Philippians chapter 2, verses 12, and then also verse 13. It says, "Wherefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God which worketh in you, both to will and to do of his good pleasure." You know, like I said, I titled this morning's message "Seasons of Change," and I just wanted to let you know that in each and every life of every believer, that there's times of seasons and times where they are certain that really they're not even in the will of God. I know that there's been times in my life whenever I know that I still loved God, I was going through the motions of Christianity, but I knew that I wasn't in the will of God. These are times when, if they're honest, they would look at their lives and they would realize, you know what, I really haven't grown very much in the faith. I mean, if I'm honest with myself, I can say, well, I may have learned some things, I might be learning some things about the Bible, but the question is, when is it going to go from my head to my heart? When is the Word of God going to have an effect on me to where it changes me internally? I had a friend of mine, he used to come to church, but I remember one time he called me up and he asked me to do something, and he shared with me how he'd been listening to this this teaching on the radio. And whenever it was talking about the gospel, simple concepts that we've really tried really hard in this church to teach, like justification and sanctification. But he was going to church, like to a church that I had gone to, where none of that was ever spoken of. And the more he learned the gospel, one day he said, he looked in the mirror and he looked at himself and he said, "A Christian for 30 years? What do you have to show for it?" And so that really pricked his heart, and the Lord began to do a work in him, and he began to study. And at the same time, I don't know really where he is with the Lord right now. What I'm talking about this morning is seasons of change, seasons in the life of the believer. When will the knowledge that I've learned go from the head to the heart? You know, the Bible speaks of people in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 7. It talks about the fact that there's oftentimes people that are ever learning, but they're never really coming to the knowledge of the truth. The truth of the gospel is never really reaching into the inside of them and having the effect on them that it should. I use this word a lot because for me it was a revelation whenever I first learned it. Now, I mean, some of you that have been with us for a while, you might be bored with it, but that word knowledge there is epignosis. Now, in the Greek, this word right here, gnosis, it's also a word for knowledge. And it really means kind of like an informational knowledge. Info. Kind of like what that scripture was talking about. They're ever learning, but they're never coming to the knowledge of the truth. But in this particular word here that we're talking about, knowledge of the truth, it's epignosis. This word means upon. So upon knowledge. It has an idea of experiential aspect to it. What I'm trying to explain to you is that as you go through seasons of change in your life, in your walk with God, that there's an experiential aspect of the things that you go through, along with the knowledge that you do learn from the Word of God, that work hand in hand through the Spirit of God in your life, and it's producing and it's changing things on the inside of you. God is conforming you into the image of His Son Jesus. Many times we don't even realize how far away we really are from the things of God, but God has a distinct way of taking those who say, "Yes, God, I want to be yours," and putting them and allowing them to be in situations that cause change to take place on the inside of their lives. I remember one time Joseph Larson, I don't know if you're familiar with Joseph Larson, but he's one of the singers at WBC at the ministry over there. And he was going through some things in his own personal life. And I can remember one day I was jogging as I was watching one of his videos. And he talked about the fact he got on the piano. He said that one time Brother Swaggart made a comment, and it was a simple word that Brother Swaggart said that brought deliverance to Joseph's heart. Brother Swagger said, if you won't quit, he won't quit. If you won't quit, he won't quit. People can say whatever they want about various people and where they are in their walk with God, but I'm just here to tell you this morning, whatever the season is of your life, if you won't quit, he won't quit. Amen. God won't give up on you. Praise God. So in this case, people have gained great knowledge that we were talking about, but yet at the same time, they haven't allowed that knowledge to result in transforming their lives. And when we review the lives of all the heroes of the faith, there were seasons of preparation. I mean, as I knew that the Lord put this on my heart, I was thinking about all the many Bible characters and how there were so many types of seasons of preparation in each and every one of their life. Trials and tribulations that they went through that God used to bring them to the place that he was going to be able to use them. If you viewed them closely, you would be certain that either their lives or the circumstances that were taking place in their lives, it just didn't really match up with what you would expect the lives of a child of God to look like, you know? I mean, especially nowadays in the modern church, especially if you turn on TBN, I don't recommend you do that, but if you do, you would expect that everything in the life of the Christian you gotta be wearing a nice suit, you gotta be driving nice cars, you need to have a bank account full of money, there needs to be no trial or tribulation in your life or else you're lacking faith. Well, that's completely contrary to the Word of God. The Word of God is filled with men and women of God that have gone through things, even after they loved God. Gone through things, found themselves in precarious circumstances, opened up doors on their own that allowed themselves to get into a mess, made decisions in their own flesh and their own strength, and it caused untold sorrow and pain. But nevertheless, if you won't quit, he won't quit. The whole time God is working through the power of his Holy Spirit in all of those circumstances, in all of those seasons. Ultimately, what God is wanting to do is, he's wanting to prepare their lives. He's wanting to prepare their lives to be used by him and to be used for him. Amen? I can tell you that that's the ultimate purpose, that it would help, but it will help you in your own life also. I got to tell you that. You know, there is something called practical Christianity. Yeah. I don't preach a whole lot about it because I am of the persuasion from the scripture that if I can teach people how to really understand the gospel and to how to have a relationship with Jesus, that the Holy Spirit is going to speak to them. Amen. The Holy Spirit is going to be their pastor. The Holy Spirit is going to strengthen them. No matter, even if I get on your nerves, the Holy Spirit will still tell you, hey, I'm the God, not the man. And if you will put your eyes on me and trust me, no matter what it is that you're going through, I will get you through this thing. Amen. I'm of that persuasion. I believe that with all of my heart. You know why I believe it? Because I have had man and woman alike let me down time and time again since I have known about God and known the things of God. People who I felt like I just gave to, like in the old church that I used to go to. I just felt like, I'm not trying to pick on them. If you watch the video, that's how I felt at times. And I realize it's not even all your fault if you happen to still watch. But that's how I felt. I felt like I gave and gave and gave and was just taken from. Right? And if you allow it to, what will happen is that bitterness will set into your heart. The enemy will use that as an opportunity to cause bitterness to set into your heart. And what you need to understand is this. The preacher, the people, we all got our own lives. We're all going through this journey together, right? And we need to learn how to hold on to the Lord, how to access his presence, how to let his Spirit do the work in us. And so when we're going through a season and we're being challenged in our life, we shouldn't be focused on what everybody else is doing and how they're all messed up. Instead, we should be focusing internally and allowing God to do a work on the inside of us. But he will change you in such a way that it can help your practical life. Amen. Lord knows, I've talked about this before, we all have rough edges. Yeah. We all have rough edges that need to be smoothed out. Sometimes those rough edges that we have in our life make it very difficult for other people to deal with us. Come on, somebody, help me out here. We each have different personalities. We all have different little character flaws that cause irritation. I'm sure that there's some things about me that if you really get to know me, that it really irritates you. But I can assure you, if I get to know you, there'll be some things about you that irritate me too. I'm not the only one that knows how to irritate people. You understand what I'm saying? God knows how to knock off the rough edges in our life to smooth things over, really to teach us a level of humility. Because if you can't learn to walk in any kind of humility, you're not going to be able to get along with God, much less get along with man. Because God's perfect. Amen. He'll never never mess you up. He'll never do you wrong. But if you got pride in your heart, then it's like the polar sides of a magnet, and it repels the presence of God, because pride is the very sin that brought the enemy down, that caused him to try to elevate himself above the things of God. Each and every one of us have pride in us.
Right.
Each and every one of us have pride in our lives, and God is trying to remove it, and He's trying to replace with that the heart of Jesus. A humble heart, a giving heart, a selfless heart. And whenever we allow God to maneuver and operate in our lives in that way, it knocks off the rough edges. It's going to start to smooth some things out. And before you know it, you'll even be able to get along with people that you thought you couldn't get along with before. But you're going to have to die to self in order for that to happen.
Right.
Sometimes it requires a season. For you to go through a season of change in order for that to take place. You know, after all, the Word says that God's people are separated out from the world and are made to be His peculiar people. Different, you know? Yeah, I mean, if you think of the way that you used to be, if God has worked in your life any at all, and you think of the way that you used to be in your relationships before, and you think of all the time that you always had to have your way. I mean, I can tell you, right now, that there have been times in my past that it always had to be my way, you know. But with time, God began to show that, you know, it doesn't always have to be your way. You have to learn how to submit to what the Lord is teaching. That's peculiar to the world. That's different, you know. Really, what the word peculiar means is God's own possession. It means that now you have new ownership. Wow. You belong to God. Well, when you belong to God, He's in the business of changing people. He's in the business of changing people and making them look different than the world around them. If you look at Titus chapter 2, verse 14, we're talking about peculiar people right now. Because we're talking about seasons of change. And we're talking about the fact that God's people look different because they belong to Him. It says, Titus 2:14, who gave Himself, talking about Jesus, He gave Himself. You know, I've used this scripture before. When I talk to people about the cross, I've talked to a lot of people that aren't as convinced maybe as some of you are that it's all about the cross, that you can't get past it. You'll never be able to move past the cross. And I've had people that have been in church as long as me or longer than me that look at me like I'm a fool for saying such a thing. You won't find the word cross in there at all, but yet at the same time, you'll probably find 3 to 4 words at least that talk about the cross. What are you talking about? He gave Himself for you. Mm-hmm. What do you think that's talking about? Okay. That's talking about His obedience to the Father, the laying down of His life. What did He do that for? That He might redeem us. What does that word redeem mean? It means to release on the receipt of ransom, to liberate through payment. What was the payment? The shedding of His blood. Amen. Jesus gave Himself that He might redeem us from all iniquity. We all had the same thing in common. I remember when I used to go to the jail, sometimes I missed that. Life was a lot more simple when I was preaching in the jail, I can tell you that. The biggest worry I had was that there might get a little pee on my elbow or something when I leaned on the thing from all the slop that from the food that fell. But look, the people that wanted to hear the gospel, they flocked to the little hole right there, and they were all ears, and I had their attention for about 15 minutes. But I can tell you that I would tell them, you know, that God desires to redeem. He desires to make a people for Himself. Amen. And He wants to redeem us from all iniquity. He wants to purify unto Himself a peculiar people that are zealous of good works. That's part of the idea of being redeemed. You've been bought out of the world. Your first birth in Adam, you were born in sin. You were born in iniquity. You were born a sinner separated from the presence of God. That's why you were so full of pride and arrogance. That's why you were all about yourself. The nature of Adam was inherent in you. But then when you got born again, you were redeemed and you were liberated out from that world. And you were brought into a new place in Christ. And in this new atmosphere, if we could call it that, in Christ, I've said this before, it's like you moved into a new neighborhood. And in this new neighborhood, you know, in the old neighborhood, things were bad. You always heard sounds that were kind of scary. You might have heard sirens that were going on because it was full of corruption. But now in this new neighborhood that you live in, there's a new element that pervades the air. It's called grace. Mm-hmm. Grace that changes, that strengthens. Because Jesus purified through the shedding of his blood, he brought us out of the old place that we were born in iniquity, and he brought us into a new place where grace abounds. He wants to make for himself a peculiar people, a people that are his own possession, that are zealous for good works for him. See, ultimately, that's what I'm trying to tell you. Part of the change that takes place in your life and your heart will help you in your practical living. It'll help you in your relationships. It'll teach you how to die to yourself. But ultimately, what God's about is he wants to use you for zealously for good works for him. Listen to me. If this world that we're living in is not really about the decision that we're going to make to give our heart to Jesus and to become part of God's eternal family, then this is a pitiful existence. I'm just going to let you know that right now. This world is that you're going to keep getting hurt. Listen, it doesn't mean that God can't heal you. Amen. You're going to keep feeling like things have been done dirty to you. You're going to keep on feeling like you know, what's it even for? But if you'll get a revelation that what it's really all about is giving your heart and your life to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and to allow him to change you and to be you and to utilize you for the purposes of being zealous for good works. Learning how to live for something other than just yourself.
Amen.
Amen. God wants to use us for something than just ourselves. And if we never get a revelation of that, listen to me, you can go to church all you want to. You can go to church all you want to. But if you never get a revelation that you are not your own, but you were bought with a price, and that you belong to him, and that you don't allow him to utilize you and minister in your life and through your life, it's not going to be a good existence.
Right.
You're not going to ever be happy. Amen. You're never going to find what your true purpose was. The word purify means to make clean or to cleanse. He purified us from all iniquity. 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 9 and 10 talks about a peculiar people too. It says, you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people. You know, these types of scriptures, they ring so true to me now that God has given me an understanding more, anyway, of the big plan that he has. That he has created a nation for himself. We just talked about it the other night, how a couple Wednesdays ago, how in the book of Genesis, God created a nation for himself. You remember that? And then the other night, we talked about Isaac and how Abraham offered up Isaac on an altar. And that through all of this, God was creating a nation for himself. Through one man named Abraham, ultimately to give us Jesus. Now through Jesus, God's creating a royal priesthood, a holy nation. Believers are a nation unto God. They're separated out from the rest of the world. Amen. They might live on different continents. They might live in different nations. But they're a holy nation, purified and separated unto God. This is his plan. His plan is that he would make one nation out of one man named Abraham. And through that one nation, he would give us a man named Christ Jesus, the sinless one, who would die on the cross. And he would allow you to experience a new birth, that you would be born again. Born again from the old and born again into the new. Amen. And that you would be called holy. Hallelujah. And you would become part of God's possession. So if one is going to say that he belongs to God, he must understand that those who are born of God are different than those who are born of the world. Once again, we discussed this Wednesday night, but to some extent, we get caught up in the outward appearance. We start looking at how something looks outwardly. And what I'm here to tell you is that God, that's not what constitutes godliness. God's looking at what takes place on the inside. We view people's appearances instead of considering what is in their hearts. Hearts of compassion and humility versus hearts that are selfish and callous. See, when the love of God and the glory of God comes to take abode in your heart, he's going to change your heart. If your heart's been selfish and callous towards other human beings, then sooner or later, he's going to start softening it up. Or you might be like them, ever learning, but never coming to the knowledge of truth. Never experiencing the changing aspect of the gospel where you allow it to change you on the inside. What we must always remember is that God is more devoted to us than we are ourselves. Furthermore, if we mean business, that we're going to serve him, then he will fashion our hearts to be molded into a shape that can be used by him. Go ahead and put Ezekiel 36, verses 25 through 27. True conversion begins with the fact that God gives the believer a heart that can be fashioned by Him. I use this scripture all the time. I think it's really one of my favorite Old Testament scriptures. And the reason why is because it speaks of the upcoming new covenant that God would perform or accomplish through Jesus. I might need you to kind of flip back and forth between 25 and 27 for the next few minutes, but we'll start off at 25. It says, we're in Ezekiel 36. Ezekiel 36, verse 25. I'll try to slow down a little bit. He's there, but Ezekiel 36, 25. It says, "Then I will sprinkle clean water upon you, and you shall be clean. From all your filthiness and from all your idols will I cleanse you. A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. And I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you a heart of flesh, and I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you shall keep my judgments and do them." So Ezekiel, and I'm kind of shooting from the hip here, but if I had to guess, I would say that we're probably somewhere around 400 to 300 BC. All right? That means 300 to 400 years before the time of Jesus. Maybe a little bit more. And what he's speaking of, once again, is that God is telling his people that there's a new covenant that is going to take place between me and you. He explained it also through the prophet Jeremiah. In this new covenant, if you go back to verse 25, the first thing he says is he's going to sprinkle them with clean water. Now, the idea of this sprinkling with clean water goes back to conversion. In the New Testament, the idea is conversion. Now, what you need to understand is that in the Old Testament, things were sprinkled with water, but it was water that was made from the ashes of the red heifer. We've taught about the ashes of the red heifer on numerous occasions, so we're not going to go into detail. But one of the things that was a revelation for me, and I know I've said this many times, and hopefully you know it so much that you're getting tired of hearing it, because that's how it should be. The red heifer was actually burned with the blood within it. Many times sacrifices that were offered up, the animal was killed and its throat was cut and the blood was poured out. And so the body was emptied of the blood. Because, see, the Word of God says in Leviticus chapter 17, "I've given you blood to make atonement for the soul, for the life of the creature is in the blood." So when the blood is poured out, the life is taken, the sacrifice is offered, the innocent dies in place of the guilty. That's what the whole Old Testament sacrifice was about. But the red heifer was burned, was killed and then burned with all of the blood in it. The ashes then were collected, and so contained in the ashes, theoretically, was the blood of the animal. And then a small tincture of that, I think that'd be a right word that you might use if you were a pharmacist. If you were going to make a tincture, you'd take a little bit of that ash and you'd put it in a portion of water and you'd make a solution out of it. And then you would be able to take that water and you would sprinkle it on things in order to cleanse them. Even in the book of Hebrews, it says most things in the Old Testament were cleansed through the blood. And it was talking about how Moses cleansed the articles of the tabernacle through blood. But what it's talking about is the ashes of a red heifer that were used in order to be sprinkled upon. In the new covenant, the idea is this, is that you were sprinkled with clean water. When you heard the gospel and put your faith in Jesus, you were cleansed with the blood of the Lamb. The next thing in the new covenant was that you were going to receive a new heart and a new spirit. When a man or woman is born again, there's an internal miracle that takes place. A miracle where their heart is made new. That which was calloused and selfish is changed to one that can be dealt with by God. Amen. In addition, the spirit of man has been made alive to the things of God. The spirit of man is that part of man that's either dead to God or it's alive to God. When you become born again, when you become cleansed, when you become converted, the spirit of you that was in you, that was originally born dead in Adam now comes to life. Do you know what I'm talking about this morning? Do you remember a time back whenever people used to try to talk to you about the things of God and it was dead to you? And then you gave your heart to Jesus and all of a sudden, hallelujah, the things of God came to life in you. Amen. That's a good thing. The spirit of man now has been changed, and not only that, but his heart has been changed. God wants to do a work on the inside. He's basically given you a receiver. God's always been transmitting. He's always been transmitting a signal. But the problem is that before we got saved, we didn't have a receiver. We couldn't hear the voice of God. Amen. But now he's placed a new heart in us. Praise God. He says it in the next part of the verse. He says that he would take away the stony heart and he would give us a heart of flesh. God takes out the stony, hardened heart that we were born with in our first birth. He replaces it with a heart of flesh, a heart that is pliable, a heart that can be molded by the Master's hand. God wants to change each and every one of us. Then he goes on to say this. He says, I put my spirit within you. And the way that he causes all this change to take place is by his spirit now living in us. Now the things of God are becoming alive to us. His word has meaning and we can hear his voice. Gradually through a process of time, he speaks to us and changes our lives to where we are prepared to live for him and bring him glory with our lives. Amen. The process where these changes take place have been called by some seasons in the life of a believer. I got to tell you, the idea is that just as there are visible changes in the seasons where the leaves change colors, there are also visible changes in the life of believers. So many times when you're going through a season, it doesn't feel good. It can be painful, but the result, are very obvious. And you, when you look back on them, you will realize that God was the one that was behind it all. These seasons many times are initiated by circumstances. God is not opposed to allowing circumstances in your life. I have to tell you that. Whether they be good or bad, to encounter the lives of his people. Like a potter with clay on the wheel of life, he adds water and he adds friction. And he molds and he shapes that pliable heart that he put on the inside of you, because on the day that you were converted, things just got started. And the reality is this, is that he who began a good work in you will complete it, amen, until the day of Christ Jesus, until Jesus returns upon this earth. God is going to be accomplishing the work that he started on the inside of your life. And so like a master potter with your life, your heart in his hand on the wheel of life, he adds water and friction, and he begins to mold and shape, and the heart that now he has placed in there that really loves him. We're not talking about somebody just got some knowledge and is never changing. No, we're talking about somebody that really loves him, that's been converted. He's molding, amen. He's changing. He shapes it into something that he can use to bring himself glory. And furthermore, if we will allow it to happen, it will result in a more peaceful life for us on this earth also. Although I must tell you that many times, once again, these seasons are painful and confusing. Nevertheless, the end result always makes sense. It always makes sense. Why? Because God's purposes are ultimately accomplished. Sometimes these seasons of preparation can result in feelings of bondage, famine, or even isolation. Not too long ago, I mentioned Joseph to you. I mentioned the various things that had happened in his life. I talked about the fact that his brothers sold him into slavery. I talked about the fact that he was thrown into a pit. If you'll remember the story of Joseph, some of you have been in the Bible a lot longer than others. Joseph was the first son that was born to Rachel, which was the bride that Jacob had two wives. One was named Leah that he didn't really want to marry. The other one was named Rachel. Rachel's womb was barren. Leah was popping out kids left and right. The first child that Rachel had was Joseph. In Jacob's eyes, he was highly favored. Jacob made him a coat of many colors to put on. It was like a symbol of the favor that Jacob had towards him. While, you know, it seems as though that this went to Joseph's head to some extent. You have to go and read the story for yourself. But the way Joseph, see, and the Lord was with Joseph. There's no question the Lord. Joseph is a type of Jesus as the suffering servant. David is a type of Jesus as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Joseph suffered for the things of God. At the same time, if you go back and you read the story, God spoke to Joseph in dreams. He revealed parts of Joseph's life to him in dreams. But the way that Joseph turns around and explains it, he lifts himself up and he tells the rest of his family, even though it was true, y'all are going to bow down to me one day. I just thought I would let y'all know that God gave me a revelation. Y'all are going to bow down to me one day. I can tell you this. Many times you will realize that God's favor is on your life. It doesn't always do a real good job, though, to go flaunting around the favor of God in the midst of your life. That's another problem that I used to have with that word of faith stuff. Do you remember, y'all remember back in the day, some of y'all that had been around some of that stuff. Oh, well, I'm a king's kid. I'm the righteousness of God, you know, and that's the way that they would talk. And you know, well, yeah, you are a king's kid. But, you know, one of the things that I realized, too, and it's kind of weird. Well, I'm not going to say that. You know, but there's two types of kids that a king could have. One's a little snotty-nosed brat that demands everything that he wants to get from God. And you ever seen a kid that just demands what he's going to get? I'm telling you right now, I don't get along good with kids like that. I really don't. Even in the clinic still today, I don't get along good with kids like that. Who in the world died and made you the authority in here is the question that I have. But nevertheless, there are other children that are respectful. They understand. And they understand authority. And they respect authority. And that's the kind of child that I want to be. I don't want to go up to God demanding and expecting and call, you know, saying that God's got to bless me. God doesn't have to do anything.
Right.
If he wanted to, he could turn his back on me. Thank God he wouldn't do that. Praise God. But nevertheless, I just need you to know that it's not a good idea to flaunt your favor with men. Even if God's favor is in your life. Sometimes we talk too much about ourselves. We talk too highly about ourselves. People, can I tell you that the enemy will already cause animosity in people's hearts towards you just because you are the child of God?
That's right.
I'm telling you right now, the enemy will try to destroy you any way that he can. He don't need no help from us. Amen. We need to learn how to allow God to do a work of humility in our hearts. I was talking about bondage and famine. I just real quick about Joseph. Joseph, once again, was a perfect example of a season. I'm talking about seasons of change. I'm talking about the fact that God works in your life through circumstances, that sometimes God allows negative circumstances or good circumstances to take place, and that through them, the Holy Spirit is ministering and operating in your life. I used the example of bondage and famine. Joseph is an example of bondage. He's an example of how bondage can take place in the life of God's people. Yeah, it was physical for Joseph, but sometimes there's also a spiritual bondage. Is it ultimately God's will that God's people find themselves in the midst of bondage? No, God would prefer we never be in bondage. Nevertheless, he also knows how to get our attention when we find ourselves in those situations. So Joseph went from being betrayed by his brothers and thrown into a pit, and then they turned around and they sold him to a band of Ishmaelites that carried him down to Egypt, where he was bought by Potiphar. And he was put in Potiphar's house in order, who meant he was like a governor in Egypt. And he was put in Potiphar's house to take care of Potiphar's things. The Bible says that everything Joseph touched flourished. The Bible says that Potiphar didn't even know what was in his house except for the bread that he was eating. That's how much he trusted Joseph. He just knew, I just got some bread right here. That's all I need. Nevertheless, his house was flourishing, his crops, whatever it is that he owned, everything was flourishing because Joseph was a good steward and took care of Potiphar's things. But Potiphar's wife, the Bible says that Joseph was goodly. The idea was he was goodly and well-favored. And whenever I looked those words up, it meant not only was he good-looking, but he was a very handsome man. And she saw that, and she wanted Joseph. And when she began to approach him, and he said, oh, no, I'm not going to sin against my God. I'm not going to sin against the master of this house. And instead, he would avoid her. But one day, he had to go do some work in the house. And she said, come lie with me. And she grabbed a hold of him. And he slipped out of his garment and he took off. And there she had it in her hand. And she accused him of trying to lie with her. And the next thing you know, Joseph finds himself now in prison. You know, the Bible doesn't really talk a whole lot about Joseph feeling negative, but if you're going to sit here and convince me that Joseph never had a bad day, come on, somebody, help me out here. Whenever his brothers threw him in a pit, and then next thing you know, this woman's lying on him, and next thing you know, he finds himself in the midst of a prison. And even while he's in prison, God elevated him, and next thing you know, the jailkeeper said, my life would be a whole lot better, I'm just letting you run this place. And everything that Joseph touched in the prison, it turned to gold. But you know what happened was that there came a time whenever Joseph got tired of being in the prison. Many times when we as Christians find ourselves in bondage, part of the problem is that we don't mind spending one more night in jail. We don't mind spending one more night in jail because we kind of like, not so much the bondage, but we like the situation that kind of got us in there. There came a time in Joseph's life when he wanted out. And the Lord used him to interpret the dreams of the butler, the chief butler, which means a cupbearer, and also the baker. They were in prison also. And the dreams had to do with, both of them had the element of three in it. And Joseph told the baker, he said, the butler said the three branches represent 3 days, and in 3 days, Pharaoh is going to release you. The baker's like, well, that sounds good. What about me? He said, well, the three baskets represent 3 days also, and in 3 days, Pharaoh's going to take your head from off your shoulders. Whenever the cupbearer was able to be released, Joseph said to him, please don't forget me. But the Bible says in Genesis chapter 40, verse 23, yet did not the chief butler remember Joseph, but forgot him. The truth is that whenever we find ourselves in situations, nobody's going to be that cause bondage in our lives. Nobody else is going to be able to get us out. And one of the things that God will teach us in a circumstance of bondage is how to be completely dependent upon Him. Amen. Nobody else is going to help you out of that deal. Nobody else is going to be able to give you the key to get you out. It's only the Lord, and you're going to have to come to the place where you want to be out. Amen. The reality is this, is that if you're willing to spend the night, one more night in jail, then you're not ready to come out. And God knows, you can try to trick your mind, you can try to trick Him, you can try to trick people that you know, you can say, oh, I'm really ready now, but God knows exactly what's going on in your heart and in your mind, and He's not going to unlock the door until He knows that you're ready. Amen. To move forward into the next season of your life. Until the time it was right, God's will in his life and heart was accomplished. Nothing that he did moved his situation forward. While Joseph's bondage was physical as he was in prison, when we talk about the lives of Christians, there are spiritual bondages that have plagued their lives for years. Repetitive failures that keep returning as a trap, time and again, leaving the believer feeling more like a failure each time they mess up with God. It's so important that we understand that God wants to free us from that bondage. But what we must understand, He knows the best course of action to cause that to happen. The other one was a famine. Not only does God allow bondages to take place, but He also allows famines, and Elijah was an example of that. He was a prophet of God that experienced the famine along with everyone else in the land, but God sustained him through ravens and a widow. The ravens brought him flesh and bread in the morning and at night, and God told him to stay by the brook Cherith so that he could drink water. But when the water dried up and there was no more water to drink, God sent him to a widow's house who herself was about to just, she said, whenever the prophet said, hey, fix me a cake to eat, she said, all I got is this little cruse of oil, this little bit of, I'm about to make this for me and my son, then we're going to go home and die. She had no hope in her own life, but yet God used simple circumstances like this in order to feed Elijah through a famine. Elijah's famine was physical, but many times in the lives of believers, the famine is spiritual. Times when we're so hungry, we're actually in the state of a spiritual starvation and we don't even realize how hungry that we are. We can't hear the voice of God. We seek God. We look for Him, but we can't seem to find Him. I need you to know that whenever the time was right, God freed Joseph from the prison. He used him in a mighty way. And when the time was right, God allowed the rain to fall, the famine to stop, and he used Elijah to come against the wickedness of Ahab and Jezebel. But in both of these men's lives, these seasons resulted in complete dependence on God. Complete dependence on God and deliverance that could not have come from a man. Furthermore, these seasons prepared them for what God's purpose was for their lives. In the letter that Paul wrote to the Philippians, the Apostle Paul is writing from prison to the church in Philippi. There are several reasons that he writes the letter, and one main one is that he wants to thank them for sending him an offering while he was in prison. So like Joseph, he's physically in bondage. And like Elijah, he's dependent on God for his provision. Within the letter, there is also evidence that many in the church thought more highly of themselves than what they should have. They had hearts of arrogance and pride. They were self-serving and not concerned about the well-being of others. Therefore, in chapter 2, he reminds them of the previous elevated place of Jesus as the eternal Word who was in the form of God before his incarnation. Jesus humbled himself and became a man so that he could serve the Father's purposes of redemption by dying as a sacrifice for the fallen human race. Let's look at Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 through 8. The Apostle Paul says, "If there be any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any bowels and mercies, fulfill ye my joy." Philippians chapter 2, starting in verse 1. "That ye be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than themselves." God is in the business of changing our prideful, arrogant hearts and becoming softened, amen, towards the needs of others. Because that's what the heart of Jesus looked like. You know, some people would probably say, "Well, I don't even hardly have time to take care of my own stuff." I realize that. We're all busy. But at the same time, that's what God does. He changes the lives and hearts of his people so that they would be willing to minister to the lives of others. He goes on to say, "Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others." Then he explains it like this. He says, "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God." Another way to say that would be that he was in the form of God, but he didn't consider something to be grasped to or to be held on to, but that instead he made himself of no reputation. He took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men. And being found fashioned as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. The heart of Jesus was humble. The heart of Jesus was giving. The idea behind this is that the people in the church of Philippi were full of strife, were full of pride. They looked down on others in the church while they elevated themselves. They didn't care about the needs of other people. They were only concerned and consumed with the needs of themselves. And what the Apostle Paul was trying to explain to them, or through the Holy Spirit explaining to them, was that they needed to have the heart and mind that Jesus had. Who, even though he was in form God, the eternal Word that spoke the worlds into existence, he humbled himself. He humbled himself and became a man. He clothed himself with human flesh. Why? Because the Bible says in Hebrews 2:14 that because the children were partakers of flesh and blood, he himself partook of the same. He became us. He became our brother. Amen. Flesh and blood in the sense that he was able now to give his life as a human being and sacrifice for us. He humbled himself and he was obedient to the Father. But we can be confident. We can be confident in the Lord to know that he can change us. Because ultimately, what God is wanting to happen and what Paul is talking about is this. He's talking about the fact that ultimately we will take upon ourselves the form of Christ-likeness. In a season of change, when you're going through things, ultimately what God wants to do in your life, he wants to produce Christ-likeness on the inside of you. Amen. He wants the Holy Spirit to produce Christ-likeness on the inside of you. Going back to Philippians 1:6. It says, "Being confident of this very thing, that he which has begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. What we need to be persuaded of is this. God will accomplish His will in your life no matter what you're facing. You can be certain of something. God will complete the work that He started in your life. Whether you are in a season of bondage, a season of famine, or maybe you feel like you're on a mountaintop, you need to understand and be confident, which means to be persuaded of the fact that God will perform the work that needs to be done in you. Amen? Amen. Philippians 2:12. Wherefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. Now, knowing this, we must work out our salvation. This is the process of living out our Christian lives. This is the process of where we are coming to the right conclusion. As God, through the energy of His Spirit, gives us desire and power, we are to walk out our Christian lives with fear. This word fear, it means self-distrust. I don't trust myself. It is tenderness of conscience, the conscience that's soft towards God. It's vigilance against temptation. It is the fear which inspiration opposes to the high-mindedness, and it says it's taking heed lest we fall. The idea, it's a fearfulness that in myself, I will fail God, I will let down God. It is a constant apprehension of the deceitfulness of the heart and of the insidiousness and power of inward corruption. It is the caution and circumspection which timidly shrinks from whatever would offend and dishonor God and the Savior. Trembling, with fear and trembling, used to describe the anxiety of one who distrusts his ability completely to meet all requirements, but nevertheless still does his duties towards God the best that he can, but knowing that if God doesn't show up and do the work, that he's going to fail the Lord. Part of this idea is like an arithmetic problem. Work out your own salvation. Like a kid that would do a problem and follow it through to its conclusion. You can't work a math problem halfway through and feel like you're going to get full credit for the problem. You got to work it all the way through to its proper conclusion. And in the case, through trials and his learning of God, he learns that he can't do it, that he will fail God. He trembles knowing that he can't accomplish it in his own strength, but that leads to the good news. Verse 13. For it is God which worketh in you, both to will and to do, according to his good pleasure. It's God that's going to do the work. You can't get yourself out of bondage, Joseph. You can't feed yourself in the famine, Elijah. But God can work in you. He is the God that changes the will or heart of his people. He put that heart of flesh in there for a reason, so he can work it and fashion it into what he wants it to look like. He not only changes the desires of our heart. He says, that's what it says right there. It is God which worketh in you, both to will and to do. God changes your will. God will change your will and the desires of your heart. Amen. If you will allow him to do that. Amen. Many times we fight tooth and nail. I don't want you to change my will, Lord. I don't want you to change my heart. I want to hold on to this. God will change the will and the desires of the heart. And not only that, though, he will also give you the strength that you need in order to accomplish what it is that he's asking you to do. Amen? That's a good word. You don't have to be stressed out and think, how in the world will I accomplish this? You're not going to accomplish it. It's the Lord, amen, that's going to accomplish it. The word worketh right there is where we get our word energy or energize. It's God that gives the energy. It's God that's allowing the work to take place on the inside. And it's all because of what Jesus did at the cross when he died for us, that put us in the new neighborhood where the grace of the Holy Spirit is in the atmosphere, that's allowing us, even in seasons of change, bondages and famines and isolation and good times and bad times, as the Holy Spirit in the midst of all of that, because I can't get myself out, Lord. I can't unlock it. Sometimes, you know, I've looked at that exit sign before and I've thought, you know, that's a good, how do you get out? whenever you're locked in something, when you're stuck, it looks easy. You just press on that door. But when the door is locked and you can't get out, when you're in bondage and you can't get out, Lord, how are you gonna? What's the exit plan? How are you gonna get me out of this situation? Amen. And I got to tell you that God has an exit plan. Amen. He knows how to get people out of bondage. He knows how to feed people in the midst of their famine. Some of you know what I'm talking about in here this morning. Some of you have experienced bondage. Some of you have experienced famine. I got good news. God knows how to feed you. God knows how to deliver you. Amen. Amen. And the ultimate conclusion of the problem being worked out, once again, is Christ-likeness. God wants to change us. Yes. He wants to change our hearts. He wants to give us humble, giving, kind hearts. In conversion, God has given us a new heart, a new spirit, and He has placed His spirit in us. We can hear His voice. We can learn from Him, but there is still a lot of the old us that stands in the way of the will of God. Therefore, seasons of bondage and famine are often found in the lives of believers, not because God wants His people to experience these things, but because He has to teach them dependence on Him. Yeah. It's in these times that we begin to learn to allow Him to mold our